look on the far left, you see in 1985, a woman in Florida emptied an aquarium with 10 lionfish in it. They had no lionfish in the Caribbean in 1985. It was a woman in Florida who had a private collection. She decided she emptied it into the sea. The lionfish, 1996, 2005, 2010. Look at the one on the right, 2014. The lionfish found itself in a brand new market, no predators, no competition, eating everybody, nobody to stop it, and we all know about the lionfish now, right? So I want you to see what you can learn from the lionfish. Not that I want you to step on a lionfish, right? But I really want today to talk about you. And before we talk about you, let me just introduce myself a little bit to you. What I can tell you is that I am currently the commercial manager for the Caribbean for Virgin Atlantic. But more importantly, when I was about 6 years old, my parents asked me what I wanted to be when I grew up. And I told them I didn't really know, but I want to wear a tie. And I was doing a master's in parasitology, looking at intestinal parasites in freshwater fish, and decided this not getting me into the tie business at all. So I decided to get into business. And a little background, I have two books on negotiation skills, The Soul and the Spirit, which is a business fable to teach negotiation, and Give More, Get More, Negotiate Your Way to a Richer Life. I want to share with you, I also have a software company called Goal Smashers. And what I want to invite you to do is that it is free for individuals to use. You can go online and you can sign up for an account, and as long as it's an individual account, it's free. You just go ahead and use it. And it's a sales pipeline management tool that helps you to manage your sales process. If you want to learn a little more about it, there's a free book as well you can download, goalsmashers.com. It's free. Just go to the website, download the book, and give you a little background on a sales process and how I could help you. As I go forward, I want to think through business strategy a little bit. And if I think about three strategies, the first one I want to think about is being a low-cost leader. And when I think about Barbados and I think about a low-cost leader, the first company that comes to mind for me, how many of you know Solo down in BlackRock? Nothing fancy about Solo.
No.
They even have a fluorescent light. There's a little panel of clear galvanized on the top there. This thing's still on the pallet. Well, everything almost expiring, right?
Yes.
But it's the low-cost leader. And how many of y'all shop at Solo? And you have certain expectations when you go there. You don't expect wide, fancy aisles. You don't expect somebody saying, good day, can I help you? But the service actually is quite good, right? So that's their strategy. Next, product innovation. If I say product innovation, which company comes to mind first? And it's one that always comes to mind first. Apple. Apple. All right? And we'll talk a little bit more about Apple, because when we think about it, product innovation might get you there. We were the first company at Virgin to introduce things like premium economy and life lab bed. That only going to take you so far, because if you have a good idea, guess what? Somebody going to copy it. So the third one I want to talk about is customer intimacy. And as you think about your business and about your brand and how you're going to grow your business, I want you to pay a little attention to this. Because as we look, for example, even at Apple, Apple actually trains their people with this acronym, right? Approach customers with a personalized warm welcome. Probe politely to understand customers' needs. Present a solution. Listen. And then end with a greeting. So Apple understands that innovation will only take you so far. Really, you have to connect with the customers. And you have to ask yourself, what problem are you trying to solve? Now, think about your business. Everybody in here, unless you're running a charity, wants to get some sort of financial gain from your business. And we normally talk about the customer, but when we look at this strategy here, what's the problem with looking at the customer?
Too far up.
They have two steps that come before the customer. And therefore, when we start thinking about it, we need to start thinking about people. We need to start thinking about our employees. And as we look at it, we start to realize that employees are really the foundation of growth. If you really want to get some figures on this, we've seen some results that suggest that 1% increase in employee commitment normally results in about a 9% increase in monthly sales. Yeah? So one of the key little takeaways I want to give, takeaway number one, is employee first, customer after. Now that sounds a little weird, because normally we get what? We get our money from customers, so we tend to put the focus on customers. But if we don't take care of our employees before we do that, then you can't put a process in place to always be monitoring how your employee is going to deal with your customer. So yes, the customer is important, but you need to put the employee first. And I want to use this example. This is a company called Stu Leonard's. It's actually near to our head office in Norwalk. And this is the sign by the door. Our policy, the customer is always right. And if the customer is wrong, just read rule number one. Right? And the thing about him, what he recognizes as a supermarket, that he realized that he was getting 80% of his revenue from 10% of the products. So what did he do? He designed a supermarket totally differently. He actually set up the front of his supermarket with that 10% of the products, like a convenience store. And then he took it back to the supermarket and designed it like PriceMart. Because he had 80% of the products there, but when he checked, that was 10% of the sales. And in that front there, if you go by the banana, they have a banana show. If you go to buy milk, there's a cow and a pet in the zoo. It's all about the customer. And I want to just really highlight that this is not just a kumbaya moment. It's money in the bank. Because in 1992, Stu Leonard's earned a place in the Guinness Book of Records for the highest per sales unit area of any food store in the United States. He only has two branches, all right? But you think about him as an entrepreneur because he's not a massive chain. Right? He's a small supermarket that understood how to reorganize his business around the customer and is putting money in his pocket. When we understand that customers drive revenue, which we do understand, we recognize that upset customers, what happened to them? Only 4% of them will complain enough, because the rest of them do what? They just go. Some of them will leave their complaint in writing. Right? Some of them will complain in writing. When people have a negative experience, how many people they tell?
Everybody.
It used to be 12. That's way back in the day. Right? Ignore that, because guess what? In today's world, yeah? One bad experience, and you're all over the place. Right? When we look at things like customer satisfaction, I like to ask this question. How many of you believe customer satisfaction is a good thing? All right, for those of you who are in a relationship, would you prefer that your partner is satisfied or loyal? You want both. Right? You see, it's only one who's your turn.
I go for satisfied.
You will go satisfied. You don't mind if they're not loyal.
I think if they're satisfied, they will be loyal.
All right. So, research has suggested, how many of you used to be a certain telecom customer and you're not dissatisfied? You're all right. But then somebody else come and say, hey, come on, check me out over here and I have a fancy new phone for you. Yeah. Will you go?
Yeah.
I didn't go.
People leave. What's up? Who didn't go? Because you're loyal, right? I like you. I like you. I go call your spouse and say, hey, she's loyal. She's not dissatisfied. The thing about it is that when you think about it with companies, up to 68% of people who are satisfied will still leave you for somebody else. Loyalty has been found to be a driver of growth. And there's an article in Harvard about the one number you need to grow. And one of the ways they measure loyalty is by asking this very simple question. The question is, how likely are you to recommend us to a colleague or a friend? Because some of you are satisfied, but if somebody asks you for a recommendation and say, well, listen, I'm good enough, but I ain't putting my reputation on the line for that. And what they found is that people who score on a 10-point scale, 9 or 10, are what you call promoters, active promoters. People who score 8 or 7 would be people who normally say they're satisfied, but they don't do anything to help your company. They're passively satisfied. What about people who score 6-0? They're bad talking you everywhere, right? They're bad talking you. So they use this thing called a net promoter score. And it's such an easy thing, because all you have to do is ask your customers, let me tell you something, let me ask you something. How likely are you to recommend us on a 10-point scale? And see what they circle. Now when they circle, you take the percentage of people who say, I'll promote you. And you minus the percentage of people who say, I'll bad talk you. And yet, don't even worry with the people who just say they're satisfied, because they ain't doing nothing for you. They're just passively going along, right? And you end up with something called a net promoter score.